Hello and welcome to the information session for the Methane Measurement and Mitigation Call for Proposals under the Energy Innovation Program. This session is presented by Natural Resources Canada's Office of Energy Research and Development. Today's session aims to provide an overview of the applicant guide and application process for this funding opportunity. Before we begin, we'd like to acknowledge that the Natural Resources Canada head office in Ottawa is located on the unceded ancestral territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe Nation. While we meet today on a virtual platform from coast to coast to coast, we acknowledge that the ancestral and unceded territory of all the Inuit, Métis, and First Nations people that call this nation home. In recognition that many of the attendees of today's session are also tuning in from unceded territories across the country, we encourage thoughtful reflection of the harms and mistakes of the past and to consider how we can each, in our own way, move forward in a spirit of reconciliation and collaboration. I would like to first address a couple of housekeeping items. Throughout the presentation, feel free to ask questions via the Q&A button on your Zoom control panel. Questions will be answered at the end of the session. Please also note that project-specific questions will not be answered during this presentation. If you experience any technical difficulties throughout the presentation, please email the program mailbox on screen. We will be monitoring it throughout the session. On the agenda today is an overview of the Methane Center of Excellence, the Energy Innovation Program, and the Methane Measurement and Mitigation Call. An overview of the applicant guide, including the eligibility, scope, and funding process. We will walk through the expression of interest form, the application process and its timelines, along with some program timelines and expectations for projects that are selected for funding. And we will wrap up with a live Q&A. We will start with the context for this funding call. The Methane Center of Excellence is a new Canadian initiative jointly led by Natural Resources Canada and Innovation, Science and Economic Development Canada to connect Canadian expertise and drive the development of innovative Canadian solutions for the measurement, reporting, verification, and mitigation of methane emissions. As part of the Center's work to facilitate funding for Canadian innovators in the methane space, the Office of Energy Research and Development is launching a call for proposals in methane measurement and mitigation, which will be the focus of the rest of this information session. Another initiative of the Center that may be of interest to this group is a methane speaker series convened by the Center to exchange new learnings and state-of-the-art approaches to methane measurement and mitigation. We are gathering suggested topics for this series on our webpage. For more information on the Center and to be kept up to date on upcoming events and initiatives, please visit our webpage, join the Center's group on the Clean Growth Collaboration Community, or request to join the mailing list at the address on the screen. The Methane Measurement and Mitigation Call for Proposals will be run through the Office of Energy Research and Development's Energy Innovation Program in support of the Methane Center of Excellence. OERD leads the Government of Canada's efforts in delivering energy research, development, and demonstration funding. The EIP is OERD's main funding program and supports Canada's energy transition by advancing pre-commercial technologies and innovations that decarbonize energy production and use. It delivers funding through targeted calls, such as this one, as well as other unique program streams and initiatives. This funding call will invest in Canadian expertise to accelerate development of more effective knowledge and technologies for methane measurement, reporting, and verification, as well as the mitigation of methane slip in Canada. This call seeks to support projects that advance approaches and technologies in two distinct focus areas. Focus Area 1 will see projects related to measurement, reporting, and verification, or MRV. And Focus Area 2 will see projects related to the mitigation of methane slip in stationary combustion engines. Now let's go over the specific objectives we aim to achieve with projects funded under each focus area. Focus Area 1, MRV, aims to improve the accuracy of detection, quantification, and localization of methane emissions in the oil and gas sector for effective design of mitigation solutions. Reduce uncertainties in methane emissions measurement and quantification. Improve methods for the integration and/or standardization of multi-scale methane emissions data collected from different technologies for effective monitoring. And advance approaches for the timely reporting of emissions data to track the performance of producers' emission reduction initiatives and provide actionable information to stakeholders. For Focus Area 2, Mitigation of Methane Slip, this focus area aims to advance technologies that can be deployed at scale in the near term to mitigate fugitive unburned methane, or methane slip, from non-mobile combustion engines and related stationary systems in the energy sector. Now on to the details about applicant and project eligibility, project scope, and available funding. This is a summary of the critical parts of the applicant guide, but please make sure to review the guide in its entirety for all details. On this slide, you can see the list of eligible applicants for this call. As you can see, eligibility is quite broad, and most legal entities validly incorporated or registered in Canada are eligible, as well as all levels of government other than federal. Moving on now to eligible projects. First, we'll go over some general requirements, and then we will jump into specific requirements for each focus area. The call for proposals is open to projects focused on the development and demonstration of technologies and related scientific activities. Technology development projects must start at a technology readiness level, or TRL, of 5 to 8, and be ready for field trials or demonstration to generate immediate impact on methane emission measurement and/or mitigation. Related scientific activities, such as measurement or verification approaches or frameworks, must be able to describe potential for impact. As outlined earlier, the MRV focus area is open to projects that advance technologies and approaches for the detection, measurement, and quantification of methane emissions in the Canadian oil and gas sector. The potential for the cross-cutting application of tools and/or knowledge into other emitting sectors, such as the landfill or agriculture sectors, will be considered as co-benefits. Proposals with applications in other emitting sectors may be submitted, but will need to demonstrate strong alignment to clean energy production, for example, renewable natural gas, in addition to methane emission reduction. This slide presents eligible activity types, but please note that projects may make use of a combination. You can also refer to the applicant guide for some examples of projects under each of the following activity types. Developing or demonstrating measurement technologies, for example, aerial, unmanned drones, land-based vehicles, and continuous monitoring systems, that will exceed standard minimum detection limits at various measurement frequencies and other regulatory requirements, allowing deployment of emerging technologies while identifying fugitive emissions for timely and cost-effective mitigation and repair. Demonstrating novel large-scale emissions measurement approaches, including data analytics, in support of measurement-based inventories. This includes developing frameworks for integration of bottom-up and top-down methane measurements for use by multiple stakeholders. Developing a verification framework allowing validation of reported emissions data over time. And the application of machine learning and data analytics for cost-effective methane emissions prediction modeling. Please note that projects with strong open and/or analytic sharing protocols of data, outputs and/or tools with key stakeholders and/or public will be preferred and will be evaluated as part of the selection criteria. As outlined earlier, the mitigation of methane slip focus area is open to projects that advance technologies to efficiently reduce or eliminate fugitive unburned methane, methane slip, from non-mobile combustion engines and related stationary systems in the energy sector. Just like for focus area 1, this slide presents eligible activity types, but please note that projects may make use of a combination. You can also refer to the applicant guide for some examples of projects under each of the following activity types. New design or retrofit of compressors, including related components and other natural gas engines. Demonstration and/or validation of new advanced engine controls for optimized operations to reduce methane from combustion. Developing novel exhaust treatment methods, such as catalyst technologies for lean burn engines. System design to capture exhaust gas. Collaboration and leveraging with non-government sources are strongly encouraged with projects in Focus Area 2, and these will be included in the selection criteria. Of course, we cannot have a discussion about our funding call without detailing the funding available for selected projects. Projects under the MRV focus area can request between $250,000 and $5 million, comprising up to 75% of total project costs. And projects under the mitigation of methane slip focus area can request between $500,000 and $3 million, comprising up to 50% of total project costs. Funded projects can have a maximum length of 5 years. This call has no government stacking limits on funding, meaning applicants can leverage other government funding to a maximum of 100% of total project cost. Please keep in mind that firstly, other funding sources may have different restrictions on stacking. And secondly, it is important to be careful about overlapping activities and funding, as it is not permitted to receive funding twice for the same activity. Now that we've gone over the details of the call, we will discuss the expression of interest form and applicant portal. To submit your expression of interest, you are required to do so in the applicant portal. The link to the applicant portal is noted on screen and can also be accessed through the applicant guide. To start an application, you will be required to register or sign in using a GC key or sign in through your bank account. On screen, you can see the list of the pages and sections of the expression of interest to complete once you open a new application on the applicant portal. We will take a closer look at the evaluated sections on the next slide, but it's important to note that all sections are important, even the ones that are not evaluated, as they may still be used to assess the eligibility of your project. The idea and declarations pages will both be discussed later on during this information session. This slide shows the criteria for how your applications will be evaluated by the Technical Review Committee for Focus Area 1. Each of these criteria is represented by a section in the Project Details page of the Expression of Interest, except for the Team and Partners, which is on the Project Team and Partners page. All the information in this slide is outlined in more detail in Appendix E of the Applicant Guide, where you will find the questions that will be used to evaluate each section. There are common sections and criteria for both focus areas, but specific to the MRV focus area, there is an information sharing section and a measurement effectiveness section. Just a note, for both focus areas, if you are collaborating with federal laboratories, please include them as a partner organization and clearly articulate their role in your project. And this slide shows the evaluation criteria for focus area 2. Just like for focus area 1, you will find more details, including the evaluated questions, in Appendix E of the applicant guide. Specific to focus area 2, methane slip, there is a mitigation effectiveness section. The second to last page of the application form is on inclusion, diversity, equity, and accessibility, or IDEA. This page will have questions about IDEA plans and asks if your organization has made any public commitments to IDEA. While voluntary, your responses may be considered during the selection process. The information in this section will be used to track progress on workforce diversity and may inform future program and policy development. Applicants are asked to confirm the details of their operations and business details on the declarations page of the application form, including through the declaration on this slide, which reads, "My organization does not conduct business dealings in any country against which Canada has imposed economic sanctions under the United Nations Act, Special Economic Measures Act, or the Justice for Victims of Foreign Corrupt Officials, known as the Sergei Magnitsky Law. Please note that business dealings in a country on this list, which includes China, does not automatically disqualify you from funding. Sanctions are often applied to specific organizations rather than the country itself. If this declaration is left unchecked, you will be contacted by a representative from OERD for additional information that may impact the eligibility of your application." On screen, you can see a list of additional reminders to be mindful of when completing your application. First, pay close attention to character limits, especially when copying and pasting from another document, as the text boxes in the form will automatically cut off any additional text beyond the character maximum. Second, a reminder that partner organizations and key team member sections are scored with a total value of 5 points. Note that uploading team member CVs is not mandatory, but could be considered during project review. Third, for partner organizations, letters of support are not required in the EOI phase, but will be considered towards industry support and participation. Finally, when you've reviewed your application, click Submit. Now onto the application process and timelines. On screen is an illustration of the entire application process. The approximate timeline for each phase is also included. This is a competitive process. Projects will be evaluated according to the scoring outlined in the application form, and projects that best fit our criteria will be selected to submit full project proposals. This is expected to happen in the summer of 2024. The full project proposal will ask for much more detailed information about the project and will be reviewed and evaluated by a technical review committee. The full project proposal phase is also competitive, and only a select number of projects will be notified of project funding. This is expected to happen in the fall of 2024. Project funding is conditional upon successfully completing the due diligence process. Due diligence will take place in the fall or winter of 2024. This marks the selection of your project, but not a commitment of funding on NRCan's behalf. That being said, between the beginning of due diligence and the signing of the contribution agreement, you will be within the retroactivity period and can begin to incur eligible costs for reimbursement. We will discuss this in more detail shortly. Following this process, the contribution agreements are signed by both parties, which is expected to take place in the fall or winter of 2024. For now, the most important thing on screen is the expression of interest due date, which is April 17th, 2024 at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Although this is still a ways away, we will now provide a brief description of the steps you will need to complete prior to receiving funding if you are selected. Please note that this will only be relevant for those projects that are conditionally selected for funding following the full project proposal phase. Again, a commitment of funding only occurs once a contribution agreement has been signed by NRCan and the proponent after successful completion of due diligence. NRCan's due diligence process covers three areas: financial, regulatory, and technical. Financial due diligence requires due diligence of your budget. This includes the applicant providing evidence that they can finance their portion of the project and have secured other sources of funding. Also, please note that your project may be selected for a third-party financial audit to evaluate financial stability. This is done on a case-by-case basis. Regulatory due diligence consists of NRCan determining if the project is carried out on federal lands and whether an impact assessment and Indigenous consultation is required. This is an internal process. Finally, technical due diligence will consist of a review of the project's statement of work and the performance of an internal risk assessment. This is largely an internal process, but some questions for the proponent may arise. Provided that your project successfully completes our due diligence process, the project team will generate a draft contribution agreement and schedules based on the due diligence budget and statement of work. Your organization will be sent the draft contribution agreement and schedules for your review. Finally, once the project team and proponents agree to the content of the contribution agreement and schedules, the package is ready for approvals. Approvals consist of preliminary internal approvals on our end, your, the proponent's, signatures, and the final signature by the Assistant Deputy Minister, marking a finalized contribution agreement. Once a contribution agreement has been signed and a project has begun, the reporting requirements become active and mandatory. Ongoing project reports are specified in the contribution agreement. The reports are typically required both quarterly and annually, depending on the report, and cover a variety of reporting requirements. The completion report is submitted at the end of a project's life, and the submission of which usually entails the release of a financial holdback. We will go into more detail about the financial holdback in a moment. Finally, the post-completion reports must be submitted annually for 5 years following the completion of the project, starting on the first anniversary following the completion of the project. There are a number of important financial considerations to keep in mind about your financial claims. In order to be reimbursed for costs by NRCan, the expenditures must be incurred and paid for by the proponent. The aforementioned holdback that is reserved for the successful submission of the post-completion report is typically 10%, but this percentage can vary. Finally, we will provide more detail about the eligible expenditure period. While the eligible expenditure period is still a ways away, as it does not occur until after the completion of the full project proposal phase, we typically get a lot of questions about this period, so we are highlighting it here. Please note that the full list of eligible expenditures are included in the applicant guide. The invitation to due diligence marks the beginning of the retroactivity period. During this period, proponents may claim up to 30% of NRCan's contribution in a retroactivity claim. In this case, we anticipate the notification of selected projects will occur in the fall of 2024, which will begin the eligible expenditure period at that point. However, applicants can only be reimbursed for expenses starting the same fiscal year that the contribution agreement is signed. As a point of clarification, NRCan's fiscal year ends March 31st. So, depending on when a proponent is notified that they have entered the due diligence phase, they need to be mindful of whether it is realistic that a contribution agreement will be signed the same fiscal year. On screen, you can see the anticipated timelines for this call. You can also find this in the applicant's guide. The most important date on this slide is the due date for your expressions of interest, which is set to April 17th, 2024 at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. This concludes the presentation today. We thank you very much for watching. We will now move on to the live Q&A portion of the information session, but if you have any questions that you would rather ask by email after the Q&A, please send them to the address on the screen. Also, if we don't get to your question, or if your question cannot be easily addressed during this time, for example, if it is highly technical, please send it to us by email.